Our next guest became a household name when Julia Roberts played her in a Hollywood hit movie 15 years ago. It was called Erin Brockovich. Let's welcome the real Erin Brockovich to Studio 10 now.
Hello, it's nice to meet you.
Hi.
Hello, so nice to meet you.
It is such a thrill and such an honour. Thank you so much for joining us in the studio.
No, it's my pleasure. Nice to be here.
This isn't your first trip to Australia.
Oh, my gosh, no.
What? You're actually back here on a new crusade. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Well, a couple of new crusades on this recent one. I'm definitely here working with the Domestic Rape and Violence Centre. I am here working on fracking, which you call coal seam gas here, and issues. And I'm also here to do some work with the Great Barrier Reef Foundation on making sure that reef stays pristine and preserved. Couple of things.
How do you feel about fracking? It's a very controversial issue in Australia at the moment because so much fracking seems to be going on in prime pastoral land and there's concern about the water contamination.
Well, we have big issues with it in the United States. So there's a right way to frack and a wrong way to frack, and they always pick the wrong way to frack. And it causes a lot of loss of water. It takes millions and millions of gallons of water to frack one well. We definitely have pollution problems with it. We're clearly seeing that throughout the United States and long-term health impacts to people. So it's of concern.
And you are such a, I think, inspiring woman, and a lot of people kind of fell in love with you in the movie based around your life. What is it that you are trying to impart to women here in Australia with your work that you're doing with victims of domestic violence?
To use their voice. You know, I am starting to do more and more women's issues as I've gotten older myself and my girls have grown up, and looking at so many of the women's issues. In 2015, we've come so far, but yet there's almost a sense that there's been a step back or the suppression still exists. And that is to work with them, to give them the confidence, to empower themselves to be able to speak up and speak out about issues that are happening to them. And so that's my greatest work that I do, whether it's in the United States or here or anywhere. I still see that women will take a step back and not always feel that they have that voice,
How do you give them that voice? How do you do it?
They have to learn to trust and believe in themselves. And women are so good at their instincts and they're born with it. And oftentimes they second guess it. But they can get to know themselves, trust that gut, and not be afraid to act on it and stand behind their own decisions. So it's their own personal empowerment.
And Erin, if we can go back to sort of where it all began, the Hinckley case was this landmark case in the United States. A huge corporation was actually poisoning the water supply. You wouldn't believe it if it was a Hollywood movie plot, but this was actually happening. And they were poisoning the water supply in the town, and people were suffering from all sorts of conditions, and no one believed it. And this is where you became this kind of legendary advocate. Character.
It did, and it actually started with, you know, not being really the person that should uncover something like that. I wasn't the doctor, I wasn't the scientist, I wasn't the attorney, I wasn't all of that, but I was still a person. I was a human, and I could see that people were suffering. It didn't make sense to me what was going on. I certainly didn't think green water and two-headed fish was now the standard, and that there was something causing all of this. So I just put myself out there. A lot of it came from how I grew up, and my parents taught me the value of stick-to-itiveness, and that's just being dogged and persistent. And so everything they gave me as to use common sense, the value of human health and welfare, the right to clean water, all of that kind of came into play. And I just stepped out there and said, you know what? This is wrong, and I'm going to give it my best shot.
You took on this huge corporation, and you won, or at least that's how the Hollywood ending goes. But is it true the problem's still not fixed? There are still issues.
The problem is still not fixed, and we're back out there again. PG&E is now having to buy up the entire town. They're looking at a 250-year cleanup because they didn't address the problem the first time. They've hid information again, and just interestingly enough, yesterday, an article came out in California about Pacific Gas and Electric and how they've been buying off judges and the Private Utility Commission to get what they want. So, they are a bad example and bad leadership and a bad role model for all businesses to follow.
So will there be Erin Brockovich 2, part of the movie?
Yeah.
We have that.
What's Julia
and
Roberts
is Julia
doing?
Roberts signed up to play in the second
one? Yeah, it's been the strangest experience of my life. You know, my joke usually is, hi, I'm Erin, I'm not Julia. And it's funny because I'll be in somewhere and someone will say to me, well, did anyone ever tell you you look like Erin Brockovich? And I laugh, and I'm like, well, no, but I am. And they're like, yeah, right. So it's funny.
I actually read just very quickly that you love Australia so much that you were thinking about applying for dual citizenship here.
Absolutely.
And how's that going?
Hello, I'm still waiting on it. I love Australia, and I mean that from the bottom of my heart. The people, the environment, the natural resources and beauty you have. You know I love the koala. It is so unique here. Mm-hmm. And every time I step foot on your soil, I feel like I've come home. So
we would be happy to have you. Erin, thank you so much for joining us.
It was my pleasure. Thank you, everybody, for having me.
Such an inspiring woman. And good luck with your campaigning.